I recognize the presence of our chairman Manish Gadia, faculty Mansi Pardiwala, past chairman Priti Sawla, and secretary WRC Arpit Kabra. We have this very interesting session today, which is on common errors that we find in company audit. Now that everybody is done with their listed company audit, now we have the smaller or unlisted companies audits going on. But before we start off with the session, may I first request all to place their hands on their heart for the ICAI motto song.
यश सुप्तेषु जागृति यश सुप्तेषु जागृति कामं 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 कामशो पुरुषो निर्विमाणः निर्विमाणः तदेव शुक्रं तदेव शुक्रद्ब्रह्मा तद्ब्रह्मा तदेवामृतमुच्यते
So friends, today we meet here under WOW series. This is the fourth session on this audit related topic. But apart from this, I would like to give you some updates on what is happening at WRC. A lot of people must be aware of it, but just for those who are not aware, we are running this charitable entities help desk. So in case if you have any issues arising out of re-registration of charitable entities, then you can post your questions on this help desk, and we have an expert panel who will answer your questions. So that's one. And the deadline for this re-registration is still only 30th June. So this is the last month. So hurry up and you can finish all your formalities and filing of the form. That's one. We also have this portal called the Khoj portal, where women members can register in case if they are looking for employment. And they can fill in their details. Employers also can register there, and they can select their candidates depending on the profile that they are looking for. And from time to time, depending on the requirement of members, we'll keep running various series and various clinics, help desk. We are all here to help you. And now, may I request Manish Gadia, our chairman, to please address the gathering.
Thank you, Rishri, madam. And good evening to all the participants. Today's topic is really very relevant because now we are in the audit period. Audits are going on. We are making various common errors while finalizing audit. It is very important that this kind of errors we should avoid. So that's why we have today with us CA Mansi Pardiwala, who is going to take us through all the common mistakes, what she has observed during as per her experience. So very important topic. Apart from that, few of the initiative what WIRC has taken is that we are for members in industry, we are starting CFO forum on 18th June, this Friday, third Friday of this month. And we are also going to start CEO Speak, a fireside chat show on 3rd of July 2021. Apart from that, technology is the thrust area as far as WIRC is concerned, and which is the need of the hour and which is the future of the profession. Keeping this in mind, we have started Tech Age series every third Thursday of the month. We are having any program on technology. Apart from that, we have also started a long duration course on data analytics, which is a 60-hour course. And for that, we have got overwhelming response. Two batches are already full. So thanks for overwhelming response on this. But apart from that, WIRC is also available on a social media. So we are available on Telegram channel. You can subscribe to that. We have also started putting updates in a short video on our YouTube channel. You can subscribe to WIRC YouTube channel. We have also come out with a program called Mentorship, where a senior people can register themselves as a mentor on the portal, and junior can register themselves as a mentee, so that the junior people, junior CA, can take the benefit of the experience of the senior people, senior professional. Apart from that, we are also started a project called TEL, which is a unique project where we are giving a training to undergraduate student, 36 hours of training. After going through this training, they can be ready to work at a CA firm. And for that undergraduate student who are not pursuing CA course, the first of the batch will be coming out, and their placement we are starting on 20th June. Those who want to hire this kind of CA student, not CA student, undergraduate student, can write to us at wirc@ici.in. So these are the few initiative what we have undertook. Apart from that, regular seminar, webinar, so we are doing it and keep on doing. So thank you very much. Over to you, Dusty Madam.
Thank you, Manish Bhai, for sharing your updates. Now may I request our past chairman, Preeti Savla Madam, to introduce the faculty for the day, please. Preeti Madam, over to you.
Chairman C. Manish Gadia, Vice Chairperson Drishti Desai, Secretary C. Arpit Kabra, Coordinator C. Ruta Chitle. It's a privilege for me to introduce today's speaker, C. Mansi Paradiwala. My dear friends, Mansi is a partner with BSR and Company LLP. She is a chartered accountant as well as company secretary. She has around 20 years of working experience, and she has worked on the working experience on statutory audit engagements for corporates in India. She has worked on clients in manufacturing, real estate, and construction and service sectors. She has extensively worked on Ind AS implementation reporting for clients, and also her IFRS experience for global clients. She has regularly conducted various internal training sessions for technical trainings for current employment, and also speaks on external forums. So on behalf of WIRC and all participants, let me welcome CA Mansi Paradiwala on this forum to take the session on common errors in audit. Thank you.
Thank you, Preeti, and thanks everyone. Thank you to WIRC for having me today and giving me this opportunity to present on a topic which is actually quite close to me. Given the fact that I've been auditing, been an auditor for more than 20 years now, when Drishti actually told me about the topic on speaking about common errors in an audit, I think this is something which any auditor would probably very closely feel related to. So what I've tried to cover in today's session is when I was trying to actually structure my presentation, I was trying to see what would be the best way in which I can convey the errors, and given the fact that the audience is going to be a combination of auditing professionals as well as some of you may be part of industry in accounting, what I have tried and covered is various financial statement captions, certain elements of the financial statements, and under each of this topic I am trying to cover what are the common, it could be an accounting error that we come across, it could be an auditing related error, or it could be a disclosure related error. So I've gone caption wise. I will encourage the participants to ask questions during the course of my presentation. I will try and answer as many questions as possible. though I may keep moving to the slides, I'll just take pause after a few slides and take up questions that may come in the chat box. Is my screen, is the presentation visible?
Yes, visible.
Okay. So let me start on the structure and the topics which I'm going to cover. So this is the broad structure in which I'm going to cover my presentation, which is the framework. What are certain key management decisions, estimates, some of the common errors in deliverables that we see. How casting call over is relevant. Auditor's report, I'll cover very briefly. Auditor's report as well as CARO certain clauses, the cash flow statement, common errors that we note. And then I go caption wise of various captions of the financial statements, right from property, plant and equipment to P&L items. And then some auditing related relevant para, relevant matters which one as an auditor needs to be mindful of. And then of course there are certain appendices. So that's the broad structure of my presentation. Let me move on to the applicable framework. So now friends, as everyone will be familiar with, the corporate audit is governed primarily by the Companies Act. The Companies Act does comprise of various sections, rules. There are circulars, there are various orders which are published from time to time. There are very frequent updates which happen. So as an accounting professional, as well as an auditor, one needs to be completely aware of what are the applicable rules and regulations, what are the changes which have taken place, and be updated about the recent developments. The disclosures on the financial statements, the final financial statements being the output which the auditee as well as the auditor sign off, which is like a report card of a company, that requires a lot of disclosures, and these have to be in accordance not only with the applicable accounting standards, but also the disclosures which are given in Schedule 3 to the Companies Act. Schedule 3 gives details of the structure as well as the presentation format for the financial statements, including various requirements on the sub-schedules and notes. The next point is on the applicability of accounting standards. Currently, all the corporates in the country would be covered either under the Ind AS, which is the IFRS equivalent standard applicable to companies in India, or they could be covered under the erstwhile Indian GAAP. There are certain accounting standards applicable to non-corporate entities as well, those are also specified by announcements from the ICAI. So knowing what the starting point according to me would be important would be to know whether you're covered under the erstwhile Indian GAAP or the Ind AS, which are the standards applicable to you. And therefore, then when you look at, when you review the financial statements as a preparer or as a reviewer, be aware of what changes to the standards have taken place, what standards are applicable, and what are the relevant disclosure requirements under particular standards. In addition to this, specifically for auditors, the auditing standards, which actually govern the auditing requirements, those are also quite relevant. There are many changes to auditing standards which have taken place in the last few years. There are guidance notes which are issued by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. All these relevant guidance notes, auditing standards, the applicable standards, the amendments, etc., thereto, are relevant for one to be mindful of what is applicable to an entity which we are auditing. For a listed entity, SEBI requirements will be applicable because SEBI would govern certain, it could be in addition to whatever is the requirement from Companies Act. So for a company which is listed, it's important to know the SEBI regulations as well. And in addition to this, there are a host of other laws and regulations. It could be a micro, small, medium companies act. It could be direct and indirect taxes. It could be industry specific laws and regulations which are applicable to a company. So the framework and the applicable laws and regulations are quite a bit. One obviously needs to be aware of all of these to ensure that there are no mistakes or errors which happen in a set of financial statements. This is just, this list is not exhaustive, but this primarily will cover possibly substantial relevant rules and regulations which are applicable to an entity. Let me move on to the next. There are certain key management decisions and estimates which are very relevant. And this is where we come across common, I would not say errors, but certain inconsistencies that we have seen in the applicability and in the presentations and disclosures. So very important for a company to identify the right set of accounting policies. There are accounting policies which are mandatory. So a particular accounting standard or a requirement from a corporate law perspective may mandate a certain policy, and there could be some policies which are optional. Now, when I talk of optional accounting policies, these are policies, for example, selecting a method of depreciation, whether to follow a written down value or a straight line method for the basis of depreciation, or when you're talking of an inventory valuation, whether to use a first in, first out method or a weighted average method. It is not a straight identification of what one wants to elect. One also needs to be mindful about the fact what the underlying business and nature of operations is. So, for example, if the way in which, manner in which the inventory is going to be consumed is in a first in, first out basis, then the selection of a FIFO method is the right method for the company. However, if, for example, you are in an oil kind of industry where the recent purchases and the earlier purchases could just be mixed and then the consumption could happen randomly, then a weighted average method is a more appropriate method for selection of inventory valuation. Similarly, when I'm talking of fixed assets, the method of manner of use of the asset, whether the asset is going to be evenly used throughout the useful life of asset, or is it that the initial period the usage is going to be higher and thereafter towards the end of the economic life of the asset, the usage will reduce. All of those factors are very relevant in determining the accounting policy. Also very important is once you select a particular accounting policy, it has to be consistently followed. There cannot be changes unless there is a regulatory requirement for a change, or if there are some changes in the business which mandate the the method which was followed was probably not reflective of the changes in the business which have taken place. So it could be on an exceptional basis, not really something which you can change period to period. In addition to this, there are estimates which management has to make on a period-on-period basis. And these estimates, a common example or common observations that we have when we audit certain entities is that these estimates are either not reviewed on a periodic basis, or if they are reviewed, the documentation or the trail to say that the review has been conducted in the right manner. One has applied all external, internal factors for the change, has done a retrospective review in the sense to see what was the past assumption taken and what has been the corresponding actual performance of the particular asset or that item, and then revise the estimate to reflect what is the change which has taken place. Now, that's something which is absolutely critical. But again, not something which we don't find being undertaken at entities on a periodic basis. So some of the estimates which I tried, which I wanted to cover are, one is the estimation of useful lives of assets. I will cover that subsequently when I come to the PPE slide also. But there is a Schedule 2 in Companies Act, which specifies what are the useful life of various assets. Those are indicative list of useful lives. The actual useful life could be determined on a technical basis based on the usage by each of the entity. And once management determines the useful life of assets, that useful life has to be reviewed periodically to basically just confirm that the useful life followed is either same, consistent, or is there a change which is warranted? And if yes, then that change has to be reflected in the financial statements as well, by way of the depreciation charged. There are cash flow projections which are very relevant when we are doing when we are carrying out an impairment assessment. You have assessment of recoverability of various assets. It could be tangible assets, it could be intangible assets. There will be goodwill which is recognized in the financial statements. There would be investments made in, say, subsidiaries, joint venture, associate, or just other companies. And when one is assessing the recoverability of these assets, it's very important that the future cash flows which are expected from these assets are reviewed by management, are prepared first by management considering all relevant facts and circumstances at that particular date. They are reviewed periodically, and then there could be assumptions on discounting, etc., which are used in the valuation in arriving at the fair value or the value at which one would fetch if one were to continue using the asset. This is very relevant for wherever there are triggers for impairment, and an impairment provision needs to be recorded. A very important estimate of management. Estimates are covered by SA 240, and the documentation related to those estimates is also specifically mentioned in SA 240, which we find in many instances being missing. Another area where, again, estimates becomes very important is when you're assessing recoverability of deferred tax assets. As everyone will be aware, under Indian GAAP, you need, when you're recognizing deferred tax asset on, say, carry forward losses, you need virtual certainty of realization of such assets. Under Ind AS, you need a reasonable certainty with convincing evidence for realizability of this deferred tax asset. Now, again, here, the company needs to estimate on what are the future cash flows. What is the future taxable income going to be? When will the company start paying taxes in a manner so as to be able to recover all the carry forward losses which the company has? That assessment again is very much dependent upon the future projections, which is dependent on the judgment, budgets, expected future performance. There could be external indicators of how the market performs. And basis that, one needs to take a decision whether some of these assets which are recognized in the financial statements, are they appropriately recognized, or do they need to be reversed? This also, in current environment, for example, what companies are going through because of COVID, there are many sectors, many companies which are impacted quite significantly. So as auditors, as management, one needs to look at these projections quite critically to see whether these are reasonable and these are achievable or not. There are assumptions which are used in actuarial valuation. When you come to employee benefits provision, gratuity and leave encashment, we have seen various instances where the assumptions are actually not in line with what is the actual trend. So a simple example on this would be the actual attrition rate would be in the range of, say, 15-20% when one looks at the past trend of the last 2-3 years. But in the valuation valuation for the purposes of gratuity, the rate of attrition which is used is, say, 5% only. Now, this 5% may be justifiable because a company does expect on a long-term basis 5% to be reasonable, but one needs to compare that with the past trend, with the actual performance, to see whether the assumption is unbiased or is it biased. So that's again an area where we've seen a lot of errors, and only during the course of audit or discussion does the company really rectify. After Ind AS becoming effective, the fair value estimates have become very, very relevant because for a lot of captions, the accounting policy would require the company, either as an optional choice or a mandatory choice, to recognize a particular asset or liability at its fair value. So the estimates of fair value which are arrived at again need to be looked at thoroughly by the auditor, by the management first, in terms of the preparation of that estimate, the management review of those estimates, and the review by an external reviewer, which could be auditor or any other regulator. Moving on to the next slide. Let me first talk about the financial statements itself. And here I'm actually talking about the financial statements as well as the audit report. This is actually the final document, and the way I call it, actually a report card of the company. This is where we have seen that after doing all the hard work in an audit, in preparation of accounts by management, by the auditor finishing their work, there are certain errors which are there in the final deliverable. a few observations which I've come across. I just thought, well, let me highlight some of those. Firstly, we've seen that at times the legal entity name is not correctly mentioned. And this is not necessarily just on one page. On all the pages, you should have the correct name of the legal entity mentioned. At times, S may be missing, or companies tend to use PVT LTD instead of spelling it properly as private and limited. This is basically identification of the legal entity's financial statements. So every page should have the correct legal name, and it should be ensured that there is consistency. There are no errors in any pages. Often we've seen that some of the pages have maybe a different name if there is a change of name in from one year to the other year, or at times if there are multiple groups and multiple entities within the group, we've seen that entity A's financial may carry on some pages entity B's pages, because maybe B's financials were used as a reference while preparing A's financials. So something very basic, but this is some this effectively reflects the quality of the financial statements of the company. The other area is on the cross referencing and the page numbering, in case there are page numbers. There are a lot of cases in the auditor's report as well as in the financial statements where there are certain note references which are given. There could be addition deletion to these notes when one is preparing the financial statements. In the final deliverable, one needs to ensure that the correct note references are carried. There are at times error in the note references. An auditor's report will say a note 42, and when you actually look at that note 42, it may relate to something else and not the matter which is referred to in the auditor's report, because the number was not changed. Again, a basic error, but these do exist. And if you actually pick up some of the financial statements of companies, you may find that even the previous financial statements had such errors. So tends to happen more where you know, maker checker controls are not adequate. The third thing, which is again similar, the note referencing between the financial statements and the notes to the financial statements. So there is a whole set of notes to accounts, what we call it. Those have references to some of the notes. Again, the note references are not correct. And a couple of times we've seen that the numbers are not correct. Possibilities, because the notes to financial statements are prepared in a Word document. The financial statements are prepared in an Excel document. So some of the changes, last minute changes, which happened on the financial statements did not get replicated to the Word notes, because the notes had to be manually updated by someone. It was not a linked number. Or there could be errors of last digit roundoff, which are not incorporated correctly. So that's again something which one needs to really be mindful of. The next observation is on the figures which are appearing in the notes to financial statements are not in agreement with the main pages of financial statements. This is actually something where I would say it's a linking error, where the sub-notes or the sub-schedules of the financial statements are not linked to the main pages. So what happens is when there is some correction, classification, presentation change, which is made in the note, that is not replicated on the face of the balance sheet, P&L or cash flow, because those numbers were never linked, or the linking was to actually trial balance. And therefore the sub-notes, either the sub-notes were not updated or the main pages were not updated. Again, it reflects very poorly on the quality of financials when one looks at such set of financial statements. The next one, which I thought is very relevant and very often missed out by experienced auditors as well as experienced accountants as well, is when you look at certain movements. So for example, when I look at an opening deferred tax and closing deferred tax, the movement between the two numbers should tally with the charge to the P&L during the year. If it's an Ind AS company, there could be some adjustments routed directly through equity also. So however, that movement has to tally. The movement is normally off. It could be rounding off differences, or it could be actually some errors which are not rectified. Similarly, when you look at opening provision for doubtful debts and closing, and you try and reconcile the movement, the movement does not reconcile with the P&L. So if there is a provision where the opening and closing, if there is no utilization, and the movement has to tally with the profit and loss account, it normally doesn't tally, doesn't match. And this is something which possibly one can only identify when one does a review, there's no linkage or referencing which one can do for this. And this is again a very common area where there are differences. Of course, some of these differences may have a valid explanation, but one needs to know whether the difference is on account of a certain fact which is valid, or is it because of an error in linking a particular number because of which the error is existing in that financial statements. The other very, very common area, I know there are there could be certain tools, etc., to now take care of busting errors, but this is something which is very irritating when you pick up a financial statement and the balance sheet doesn't tie up, the assets and liabilities are off by 1 rupee because there was a casting error which was done, or the total, if you just add up the line items within a particular schedule and just add up the last digit, it does not tally with the closing or the total number because of a 1 rupee rounding off error. Now this is something which is absolutely avoidable, but having said that, after having looked at so many financials over so many years, I'm still yet to come across a financial which comes to me for review for the first time which does not have a single casting error. So an area which is very common, very I'm sure most of you could have dealt with casting errors. There are ways and means to put in formulas of rounding off, etc., to ensure that such errors don't exist. But coming from old school, I think we still manually want to add the numbers and ensure that, you know, there are no casting errors in the final deliverable which you are going to be signing off on. The other area which I probably again something which is absolutely avoidable is to have grammatical errors in drafting. So the language or the certain notes which are drafted, the English is not correct, the context is not correctly conveyed, or there are simply typo errors, spelling mistakes in the financial statements. I mean, some of these things just cannot exist because all the hard work which is put in getting completed a financial statements for the year-end audit, and including from an auditor's perspective, the amount of efforts which is spent in completing the audit, you know, I would not say go completely down the drain, but they don't get appropriate appreciation if there are such errors which are there in the financial statements. And one way to avoid this, I mean, I believe that's possibly the best way, is to get someone who is independent of that audit, independent of preparation of financial statement, both from a management perspective as well as from an auditor's perspective. Get someone who is not involved in the process for preparing the financial statements or reviewing the financial statements to independently just read the financial statements to identify such errors, deficiencies, and any kind of missing disclosure. So something which you call very simply as a proofreading, I think that's something which is absolutely important for us to do before an accounts, before a set of accounts is adopted in board meeting and signed off. Okay, moving to the next the topic which I'm going to cover briefly is more relevant for the auditors and those of you are my colleague professionals who audit financial statements. Very, very relevant for you guys. What I've tried is I've covered a few observations, and I've also put across the relevant guidance which one can refer to for those specific areas. Let me cover one by one the points. Firstly, let me talk about auditor's report. So there are illustrative formats of auditor's report which are given in the auditing standards. SA700 to SA706 have all the formats of the auditor's report. 700 is a clean audit opinion. 701 covers key audit matters. 5 and 6 are for modification and for emphasis of matter. These audit reports have with various examples, exact wordings in the financial statements, in the auditor's report, which need to be given. We have seen when you review a particular audit report which comes to you, there are deviations from the illustrative format. Now, a deviation from illustrative format where there is no option given to include a particular change is an absolute no. Because the audit report format has a particular structure, has particular content, which has gone through all the reviews before it was finalized. So this is something which absolutely one should follow. And there are paras, etc., where you need to bring in specific fact pattern. Those are left open for the teams to update. Only those changes should be incorporated. Also, I have seen that the structure at times of the audit report is changed, or something, if it may be considered not applicable, has actually been deleted from the audit, format of the audit report. Again, some of these changes should not be done. The format is what it is. If something is not applicable, the format actually gives you an option to say that this is not applicable. So ensure that the illustrative format, the final format which is followed for an audit opinion, is in line with the illustrative formats which are given in the auditing standards. That's one area which one needs to be very careful about. There is a new section called Key Audit Matters. Now, this is introduced and applicable for listed companies from last year onwards. This is something which we have seen. Again, the drafting of Key Audit Matters is not very robust. It is the Key Audit Matters, again, may not be applicable to all of you, so I'll not spend a lot of time. But this is an area which are considered to be areas of focus by auditors. One needs to very clearly bring out what was the key audit matter which was relevant for the audit. What is the quantification or impact of that particular area? And what exactly was the subject matter? Was it a valuation of a receivable? Was it impairment of an asset? Was it going concern? What was that exact matter which was relevant for an auditor, where there was significant management judgment involved? That needs to be brought out very clearly. The impact of that particular area onto the financial statements has to be very clearly brought out. And what were the audit procedures performed by the auditor to address that particular area of focus? And what was the conclusion? All these elements should be very clearly and in a very crisp manner be brought out in the key audit matters section. We've seen that the drafting of key audit matters section is not really very specific, and sometimes it's generic, picked up maybe from some other entities and not be relevant to that client. So this is something which one has to be really mindful of. Not applicable to all, so possibly, I mean, this is something which one can actually take up an entire separate session on this particular topic. The other area which is very relevant is the other information section. Now, there is a specific tab or para on other information which needs to be given. SA 720 covers other information. This other information is basically the information related to the information which is forming a part of annual report of the company, which is other than the financial statements. Now, for smaller companies, it will be the director's report. For the listed companies, it could be MD&A and director's report, which form a part of the annual report, which could have information related to financials, which are very relevant. As far as SA 720 is concerned, the auditor's responsibility on other information is to read that other information and ensure that there is no inconsistency in the matter which is covered in that other information. From what your understanding you've developed during the course of audit or various disclosures in the financial statements. Now, let me give an example here. Say in the director's report, there are certain forward-looking statements which talk about projections being at a particular level on certain captions, or it could be just basically revenue projections where management is exploring various geographies, etc., and because of which they expect very high revenues. Now, this, when you compare with the projections given to you as a part of, say, your going concern assessment or as a part of your impairment assessment for any cash generating unit, if the information given to you was contradicting, because their management had possibly said a very subdued kind of projection versus what they've given in the director's report, if they are inconsistent, then it is auditor's responsibility to bring out that fact in this other information paragraph. More often than not, we've seen possibilities of one, the other information is never ready when the accounts are ready for adoption, and especially this is for small, medium kind of companies. So director's report is not provided to you when you're signing off the accounts, something not acceptable. Second, there could be financial related information which is not completed in the director's report. Thirdly, there could be certain changes to director's report which is done subsequent to the board adopting the financial statements. Now, some of these situations, there are there is guidance note. It does deal with such situation, but very simply put, as an auditor, you need to very clearly get this information, read through this information, and ensure that it is consistent with your understanding before you sign off the financial statements. A very important area, but again, something which gets missed out and gets picked up at a very late stage of audit, and it may then have an impact on your sign-off dates, etc. Let me move on to the other areas, and I'm not going to cover each one in detail, but I'll just touch upon all of them. Modification of audit report, which is basically qualified report or an adverse report, and giving an emphasis of matter in the auditor's report. The qualifications, the basis for such qualifications, we've seen that the drafting of this is again very generic. It does not bring out the real subject matter of qualification. It does not bring out the quantification correctly, and it does not refer to the right set of accounting literature, which the company has not followed because of which the auditor has considered including a qualification. So it's important for one, wherever there are qualifications, please be very clear in terms of what exactly is the subject matter of qualification, what is the underlying accounting standard, auditing standard not followed because of which you're giving a qualification, and very important that the qualification has to be quantified as well. So we've seen inconsistencies there. When you have qualification, there are certain other elements in the auditor's report where you have to bring out the fact that your that particular area is subject to the basis of qualified opinion para. That subject to and the reference is not incorporated at all places. So for example, there is report on legal and other regulatory matters which comes in, where you need to say that the accounting standards aren't, the company has complied with all the relevant accounting standards. Now, if there was a qualification on a particular accounting standard, one needs to say that the company has complied with the accounting standards subject to the one which is mentioned in that basis of qualified opinion para. That subject to at times is missing. We have seen that the relevant impact of that qualification, wherever applicable in the auditor's report, is not given correctly. And the next one is, which I covered briefly in the casting call over slide as well, is the correct references of notes to accounts is not given. So when I'm putting in a qualification, there has to be a detailed explanation given in the notes by the management on that particular matter and what was their basis of conclusion. That note has to be referred in the qualification para. That we've seen is either incorrect or at times is missing. So the relevant auditing standards which covered the qualifications, modifications in an audit opinion, as well as emphasis of matter, are 705 and 706. Again, very good illustrative examples given in the standard itself. One just has to ensure that those are followed properly. Let me move on to the other topic, which is on other matter para. So there could be instances in an audit report where you're incorporating other matter paragraph. Some cases it's mandatory. So for example, when I'm relying on other auditors, when I'm giving a consolidated opinion and the underlying work for some of the subsidiaries, joint ventures or associates is not done by me, is done by some other auditor, we need to bring out the fact that we've relied on the other auditor. There we have again seen the standard very clearly requires if it's a subsidiary, then you have to give assets, revenue, profit, impact on cash flows, which is by other auditors. If it is a joint venture or an associate, then it is only the profit before tax and it could be the cash flows. So these are very clearly defined parameters which one needs to bring out. But we've seen there are inconsistencies in the key indicators which are given, which are not in line with the requirements of the underlying auditing standard. Also, the auditing standard allows you to give the amounts where you're placing reliance on other auditors, amounts before or after elimination, but one needs to bring out the fact that whether the amounts given are before or after elimination. So when one has followed whichever method, either numbers before elimination, then should specify that these are before elimination. If it is after, then specify it's after elimination. Again, something which is which we've seen very frequently missed out. Similar to where you're relying on other auditors, there could be certain accounts, certain subsidiaries, associates, JVs, where management has not got the underlying audit done at all. So these are based on management accounts, could be very immaterial small subsidiaries because of some restrictions. But again, the disclosures here in respect of what is the total quantum of the assets, revenue, profits, cash flow as applicable, which is not covered by us and based on management prepared results, that's also not given clearly. So this is something one needs to be very careful of. The SA 510 specifically, which is on initial audit engagements, requires if you are the first time auditor and you've relied for comparatives on a predecessor auditor, you need to bring out that fact. Now that's again something which we've seen in many audit opinions where we are auditing for the first time. The incoming auditor has not given that other matter para. It's a non-compliance of an auditing standard. Again, a very serious error. Let me move on to IFC opinion. Like I said, the standard wordings have to be followed. There should not be deviation from standard wording. In an IFC opinion, I've seen some of the colleagues using words. The controls are generally operating effectively. I mean, when you say generally operating effectively, if they are not operating effectively, if there is any specific control which did not operate well, it was either not designed or was not operating well, then bring it out as a modification. If you're convinced that all controls are operating effectively, then say specifically that the controls are operating effectively. Using a word generally operating effectively is not appropriate. Now that's something which the standard language also does not permit, and that's a way which I've seen maybe some colleagues use to say that, you know, there could be one or two errors, but that's not allowed. If there is one sample which did not work effectively, then you either bring out a modification or you're convinced that there is absolutely no non-compliances and therefore controls are effective. So avoid using such words as generally operating effectively. Some of the other observations which I've had in my experience is the whole assessment of applicability of CARO or IFC is incorrect. So companies, it could be auditors have concluded that CARO is not applicable, or say giving an IFC opinion is not applicable, but whereas actually it was applicable. And this is because of the fact that if you are a private company, then there are certain relaxations given from applicability of IFC as well as applicability of CARO. But what one misses out is if a private company is a subsidiary of a public company, in other words, the holding company is a public company, then the private company by definition itself is not a private company. So those exemptions, relaxations which are given by either CARO or IFC, which are relevant for those private companies, which are actually private companies, those don't apply to you if you're a subsidiary of a public company. And this is something which is very often missed out. Again, some parameters for IFC evaluation or CARO evaluation are dependent on either the last audited balance sheet or it is, say, borrowings, which is at any point of time during the year. So assessment of those at any point of time during the year or as at the last balance sheet date or at the reporting date, those are not done in an appropriate manner. And because of which you end up not including a CARO annexure or an IFC annexure when it was applicable. Or it could be the other way around also, you end up giving something which was not applicable. So an area which one needs to be mindful of, look at the CARO guidance, look at the publication, the circular which gives exemptions, and see whether you really fit into those exemptions or not. Some of the other matters are, for example, if you have any books and records which are maintained at branches, and including, say, branches not visited by you, those are not correctly captured in the auditor's report. And one thing which is very relevant is whenever you are signing the financial statements, there has to be, as per our report of even date, a wording which is mentioned, because the financial statements cannot be read with or cannot be signed off independent of without the audit report. The audit report has to be read along with the financial statements. So wherever there are signatures, say on the last page of notes to accounts or on the balance sheet, P&L, cash flow, statement of changes in equity pages in case of Ind AS company, all those pages have to have as per our report of even date, because you're referring to your audit report. in the financial statements, and the financial statements sign off cannot be read independently. It has to be with the auditor's report. The as per our report of event date is very often found missing on some pages. So again, something which one should really be mindful of. At this stage, I can just take a pause. Are there any questions? I can't see the chat box.
Yeah, Mansi, the chat, those questions we will put up at the end.
Okay, sure. So I'll continue then.
Yes, please.
Okay, let me move to Caro, some of the observations. I've covered caption-wise Caro observations as well. So I'm just covering some which are not covered in subsequent slides. One is when you come to Caro, and of course, Caro 2021 will be applicable soon for this year, but I'm covering the old Caro, which is currently applicable for March 21 engagements. When you look at the statutory abuse clause, this is one clause where I've come across numerous cases of errors. In case of undisputed dues, where we are required to specify the delays, we are required to basically comment on whether the company is regular in paying its dues within the due date or not regular. And if there are irregularities, whether there are slight delays or serious delays, in how many cases. So the slight and serious actually indicate the number of days of delays, and the few or large number of cases in relate to the quantification of the number of cases in which the delays are observed. Now, if a company is very regular in paying all the dues and there are absolutely no delays, avoid the use of word generally. Say the company is regular. If the company is not regular and there are instances of delays, but you believe those instances are very few and slight, then only use the word generally regular. So be very clear when you are using generally regular and regular. The guidance note on Caro here specifically gives examples of each of the specific case on how you need to draft the number of days delay, whether these are slight delays or serious delays, and number of instances, whether these are few cases or large number of cases. There are examples given with the exact language in the guidance note, but I've seen again in my experience that this is not followed by most of the teams. So be very clear when you're drafting this. This has serious implications if you're reporting something which is not factually correct. The other piece is on outstanding dues. Now, undisputed dues, which are outstanding for more than 6 months, there is often a confusion on more than 6 months from the balance sheet date or more than 6 months from the date they became payable. The requirement here is more than 6 months outstanding from the date they became payable. So if a due date was, say, 30th September, and till 31st March this amount is unpaid, then it becomes a matter which you need to report on. Now, if something was due in, say, December, and on the date when you're signing off the audit, the 6 months period has not elapsed, then you may not need to report it in the current year. It will be a matter of reporting in the next year. But this is again an area where there are errors which are observed. The amount which is lying unpaid for more than 6 months from the due date of payment is not correctly reported. The other element which I have seen is for, again, undisputed dues, the Caro clause is very clear. It specifies provident fund, ESIC, then your goods and service tax, income tax, and any other material statutory dues. Now, if there are any other material stat dues which are applicable to your entity, then those have to be included. Very often, the list is restricted to only the items which are specified in Caro. A company may have significant property tax applicable. They could have, say, labor cess applicable, or it could have profession tax applicable. While these are not included in the Caro clause itself, any other material statutory dues covers all of these. So now please ensure that all applicable taxes based on the significance are included while reporting in Caro. Also, another area which is a common error is where you are reporting the disputed tax dues. The guidance note very clearly specifies that if there is any amount paid under protest against those disputed tax dues, this needs to be reported. We have seen instances where such amounts are only the demand is reported, not any amounts paid under protest. So this is, again, a common error which is observed. One should be mindful of this. When you come to disclosures on fraud, The while CARO does not allow the use of word material, the guidance note on fraud reporting under 143.12 includes the matter, includes the concept of materiality, and also the guidance note on CARO specifies use of materiality. So one may consider using material frauds, and again another area of disconnect is that whether you should restrict yourself to frauds noticed or reported during the year. Well, the fact that if a fraud is not noticed or reported during the year does not absolve us as auditors from the responsibility of reporting on fraud. So one needs to be mindful and take appropriate management representations, perform appropriate audit procedures to ensure that there are no frauds which were unnoticed also during the year. But this is again something which one needs to be specifically mindful of, given depending on the facts and circumstances, and depending on the stage at which your company is, and the instances which are either reported during the year, or possibly if you come across something which is though not reported but quite relevant. So that was on fraud. There are other clauses, two clauses actually. One covers the utilization of funds in respect of funds which are raised through an IPO, public offer, or term loans. One needs to specify whether the term loans and the other funds were used for the purposes for which they were taken. And then there is a separate clause which covers preferential allotment or private placement of shares, fully or partly convertible debentures. In this case also, whether the funds were used for the purpose for which they were taken on. Now, in both these cases, specifically for term loans as well as, say, a fully or partly convertible debenture, we've seen instances where maybe at the end of the year, the funds were not fully utilized, or they were temporarily used for, say, making investments, or they were temporarily invested in mutual funds, fixed deposits, etc., till the time they are not fully deployed, or they may be used for purposes other than for which they were taken. Now, all these scenarios have very clear reporting implications, but we've seen that at times that these are not reported appropriately in the auditor's report. So just be mindful of this. The guidance note does cover examples and does cover specific instances where, including the language, if at all they are temporarily used for another purpose, and what happens to a situation where it's not used till the year end and used actually in the next year. So both the years will have some reporting implications. The guidance note does cover that. So be careful when you're drafting this clause as well. Okay. Now let me move on to the cash flow statement. At least personally, a favorite statement of mine. I love actually reading cash flows, and I have seen numerous kind of errors in cash flow statement. The relevant literature for erstwhile Indian GAAP companies will be AS3, and for Ind AS companies, it's Ind AS 7. What are the common errors when you look at operating activities in a cash flow statement? All non-cash items have to be added back to the profit before tax or loss before tax, which you started off with. We've seen some non-cash items are not getting added back. Lots of errors in movement and working capital. And I've just tried to list out a few examples. So for example, a capital advance, which is grouped under either loans and advances in case of a non-Ind AS company, and in case of an Ind AS company, this would be grouped under other current assets. Capital advance is a part of your, this will be an advance given for a capital asset. So it needs to be presented as a part of investing activity and not as a working capital adjustment. So when you're presenting your working capital adjustment, capital advance has to be adjusted. Very often seen that this is not done. Same way, if there are any capital creditors, the capital creditors is nothing but a liability unpaid towards a capital asset purchase. So again, when you present the expenditure incurred on purchase of fixed assets, property, plant and equipment, etc., that is where you have to adjust the closing balance and the opening balance of capital creditors, not when you're presenting other current liabilities or financial liabilities in a cash flow statement. Very often missed out. Interest payable and interest receivable both. Interest payable, let me cover first. The opening interest payable and closing interest payable has to be adjusted to the finance cost during the year and presented against a cash flow from financing activity, not to be adjusted in other current liabilities. Similarly, interest receivable, opening and closing have to be adjusted to your interest income during the year and presented under investing activities and not as a part of other current assets or other financial assets. Advanced tax paid, there is a separate payment of tax which has to be shown separately from other working capital adjustments, but we've seen that advanced tax sometimes is not adjusted and it is captured in movement in loans and advances. Similarly, if there are interest on delays in payment of payment of taxes or there is interest on income tax received, this is not adjusted in operating activities. One should add back or reduce it and show it appropriately as a part of tax items rather than as a part of operating activities. If there are lease income or lease expenses paid, this will be part of either a financing activity or an investing activity, depending on whether you are a lessee or a lessor. Those are not as a part of your operating activity. And similarly, there are foreign exchange adjustments, foreign currency receipts payable, there could be unrealized gain losses. Those are non-cash items. These also have to be adjusted to the operating activities, but we often see that these are not adjusted. So these are some of the errors which I've come across in the operating activities. When I move to investing activities, very often when one tries to reconcile the proceeds from sale of fixed assets, which is reflected in the cash flow statement, with the movement in the block of assets, which is presented in the FA schedule, so deletion from the gross block and deletion from accumulated depreciation, and with adjustment of profit and loss on disposal, it should tie up with your proceed from sale of assets. Does not reconcile in many cases. So this is something which one needs to really look at. Similarly, there are cases where expenditure on property, plant and equipment and expenditure on addition for CWIP is presented on a combined basis. This, as per the standard, if it is material, needs to be shown separately. Then when we have fixed deposits with banks, which have a maturity, original maturity of more than 3 months, these are not part of cash and cash equivalents. Cash and cash equivalents is very clearly defined by the standard. So if there are deposits with more than 3 months maturity, then these have to be presented as a part of investment activities. Again, at times missed out. The loans which are given to related parties and the interest income earned on that, related or unrelated parties, is again an investing activity, may not be operating activity, but at times the loans are not adjusted. They are just shown as a part of working capital adjustment and not separately as investing activity. Also, the standard very clearly allows only some items to be presented on a net basis. And if the settlement is not going to be on net basis, these are loans given and received from different parties, these should not be presented net. But we've often seen that the loans given / repaid net presentation is made in the cash flow statement, which is incorrect. Okay, let me move on to the next. In case of financing activity, dividend paid very often gets reported wrongly as an investing activity. Dividend paid is a financing activity. Dividend income is an investing activity. So this is something which one needs to be careful of, because dividend paid is on equity shares, and equity shares are a source of finance for the company. It is a financing activity versus dividend income, which is earned on investments made, which is an investing activity. Similar to what I just covered in loans, loans given, in borrowings also, the receipts of borrowings and the repayment of borrowings at times is netted off. This netting off as per the standard is allowed only in specific cases, which I think is only working capital adjustments. Otherwise, this netting off is not allowed. And long-term borrowings versus short-term borrowings cannot be offset against each other. But we've seen entities presenting this on a net basis, which is also incorrect and not in line with the standard. For companies following Ind AS, we've seen the fair value changes to borrowings. It could be because of modification of agreements, or it could be because of effective interest calculations. Those fair value adjustments are not cash in nature. They are non-cash. They need to be disclosed as a notes to cash flow and not as a part of financing activity. Very often these adjustments are missed out. Some of the other observations on cash flow statement. The standard requires us to present the reconciliation of cash and cash equivalents as per cash flow statement with the cash and bank balances in the financial statements. That note is often missing. Disclosures of restricted cash balances, wherever there are cash and cash equivalents which have some restriction, those have to be disclosed. Those are also missing. And of course, casting errors in cash flow are very, very prevalent because especially in working capital adjustments, the movements are off by 1 rupee. 1 rupee or 2 rupees because of rounding off some of the subtotals and the main totals. There are casting errors of last digit. So absolutely important to ensure that there are no casting errors in a cash flow statement as well. Okay, James. Now let me move on to each of the financial statement caption. I'm just conscious of time, so I'll go slightly faster here. Now what I've tried to cover here is going to be the accounting, auditing and disclosure related aspects for various captions. And I'll just cover very briefly what are the common areas that one needs to be mindful of. And based on our past reviews, etc., we've noted errors in these areas. So for property, plant and equipment, identification of cash generating unit when you're doing an impairment assessment, whether it's an individual assets or a combination of assets, is very important. Either it's not documented well, not identified by management appropriately, or there could be errors in the way each unit is identified. The way a CGU is defined is the smallest unit of independent, which smallest cash generating unit which generates independent cash flows, which is not dependent on any other asset, and it can run by itself. So one needs to be very careful in identifying the CGU. Identifying the indicators of impairment and assessing the value in use involves a lot of judgment. It involves projections, future projections, and these have to be reviewed thoroughly. What we've seen missing here, like I covered in the estimates part also, is that management review of these estimates in terms of how these are prepared, how these are reviewed. Is there a retrospective review, whether based on the past trend, what was given as a projection to you last year versus the actual, does it stand test of review or not? All of those we've seen are missing. And it again results in, it could result in management bias over some of these assumptions. For an Ind AS company, where you have investment property, disclosure for fair value of investment property is required, including the method used for fair valuation and what are the significant assumptions used in this fair valuation. Those we've seen missing disclosure for Ind AS companies. Coming to depreciation, some of the common errors are there is a disconnect or there is a slight difference between the date when the asset is ready for its intended use versus the date when the asset is actually put to use. Income tax follows depreciation from the date when the asset is put to use. However, when you come to accounting standards, the accounting standards require depreciation to be charged from the day the asset was ready for its intended use. It may be possible that the asset is still not put to use. So that's a difference between the literature under accounting standards and income tax. But we've seen more often than not companies follow what is required as per income tax and capitalize the day asset only when it is put to use and not when it was ready for use. So again, something one needs to be mindful of when you're auditing, even from a management perspective, when you're preparing financial statements, be mindful of this so that you avoid disputes or discussions with auditors at a later date. The useful life of assets, as per the management has to assess the useful life of these assets. The indicative rates are given as per Schedule 2 in the Companies Act. We've seen companies follow Schedule 2 as is. While it's not incorrect, but one needs to assess their own useful life of assets. Possibility is that you may be genuinely following a shorter or a longer useful life and not really what is followed in Schedule 2. However, at times that assessment is missing and blindly Schedule 2 rates are picked up, which is incorrect. At times, we've also seen rates which are picked up are straight away from income tax without really seeing whether it's really applicable to you or no. This again is just to avoid differences between book depreciation and tax depreciation. But the assessment is actually very relevant here because the facts and circumstances of each company could be different. And therefore, you need to see what is your pattern of usage, what is your actual disposal of assets, when do you consider your economic life to be over, and basis that depreciate your assets. Otherwise, you will end up with unnecessary gain or loss on disposal, which is incorrect. This useful life, again, the standards require management to review on an annual basis. At times, we've seen that this review is missing. The documentation related to this review is also missing by management, and this again reflects on the internal financial controls of management. So please ensure that there is adequate evidence that the useful lives are first determined appropriately, and second, they are reviewed periodically. Another common area where we've seen gaps either in documentation or in the assessment itself is identifying components of property, plant and equipment. There is very clear guidance which says that you have to identify separate components. If these components have independent and separate useful life, then these have to be depreciated over that period and not the entire asset. This assessment is very often missing. Could be because it's cumbersome or it is tedious to maintain different component of assets, but the possibility is that then if that part is disposed of, while you may have a long asset having a longer useful life and one part needing replacement every 4-5 years, and you did not identify that as a separate component, eventually when you will replace that component, the subsequent addition, even though that could be capital in nature, you will not be allowed to capitalize because you did not separate that component in the first place. So again, an area which is important, we find some companies doing it very nicely and diligently, but very often this is getting missed out as well. Again, especially for small and mid-sized companies, a very detailed assessment on this is often missing. CARO requirements on fixed assets, a complete register, FA register, and needs to be there, to be maintained. Auditors need to comment on whether the asset register is complete or not. Very often we've seen a few details, like for example, the quantitative details, what was the number of items, is missing in that register. The location of asset is missing. And very important, the identification or tagging of that asset is missing in the register. And with such facts, if as auditors you are saying, you're giving a clean opinion in CARO, it's incorrect for you as well. And if as a company you're not maintaining these details, then it's going to be a problem for you as well. So again, a common area where we've seen errors during the course of audit. The second area is a physical verification is required. Management needs to define what is the frequency of verification looking at the nature and size of assets. And as auditors, you are required to comment whether the physical verification program, the frequency which is determined by management is reasonable. And second, whether as per that program, all assets are verified or not. Again, common observations here, common errors which are noted here. Is one, there is no proper program in case whether, and you know, normally it is when auditors will want to finish CARO reporting and will ask questions, management will say, okay, annually lik do usme, okay, once in 3 years lik do, what is there? But it's incorrect, because what you're following in practice and what is being reported, if there is inconsistency, then you are again inviting trouble for yourself as well as your auditors. So very important to have a proper program in place. Depending on your type of nature of assets and your industry, ensure that program is followed thoroughly, and that program should be such that you're covering all your assets in a phased manner over that specified duration. And if there are years, and especially now, this is an area which I possibly want to focus more, maybe take a minute more to explain, especially because we are the last 15 months for most of us have been work from home. So while yes, I know some factories, some offices have been working, but the possibility of physical verification in the last 15 months, even if there was a plan in place, would have been not possible, because for the simple reason that access to these locations may be restricted. So again, something which is very relevant and very important when you're reporting in CARO. So be factual. If it was not verified, say not verified, rather than saying that, just take a print of the register, sign and give it to us. So something which one should be mindful of. Title deeds of immovable properties. CARO requires you to specify whether the immovable properties, the title deeds, are in the name of the company. Very often we've seen, I'll give you a couple of examples where there is a merger or acquisition which has taken place, or a name change of the company. We come across the fact that the properties were actually either in the erstwhile name of the company which was acquired, or in the old name of the company, and the records of the legal records, the land records, etc., have never reflected the updated name. But unfortunately, the auditor or neither the management ended up reporting this in CARO. Second, I've seen gaps between when you reconcile with your FA register as well as investment property block of assets. You may come across certain land building which is reflected in the register, but when you verify the title deed, maybe it was not included. And some of these could be very old. So maybe either your FA register is not updated appropriately, or the immovable property title deeds have not been updated properly. Also, possibility is where you have given assets on mortgage. The original title deeds may not be available with the company. So the reporting in all of such instances becomes very important. So one needs to be very careful when you're reporting these matters and ensure that whatever is factually reported is adequately backed up by appropriate documentation and there are no gaps. Some of the other areas in a property, plant and equipment where we've seen some errors is if there are certain assets which are pledged or mortgaged for a borrowing, the disclosure is often missing in the financial statements. Assets not held in the name of the company, while it's required to be reported in CARO, there is also a disclosure requirement. This is again something where the disclosure is at times missing. When you're having transactions with related parties, especially when I'm purchasing assets or selling assets to related parties, one needs to be very careful of the arm's length bit of the transaction, because it may not be your normal business to sell these assets. It's just that maybe the asset has no longer use for me, but my subsidiary needs it, so therefore I'm selling it to my subsidiary. Here the arm's length assessment and the documentation for the valuation becomes extremely critical, because it's not a normal transaction. You're not in the business of selling that asset. And especially for the acquirer, when you're acquiring such asset, very often we have seen that the depreciation which is used, or useful life which is used, is the complete useful life. So for example, if I'm transferring a plant and machinery and I'm using 15 years as depreciation useful life for plant and machinery, the company which has sold the asset, say, use the assets for 6 years, the recipient has to now depreciate it, the cost at which they acquired the asset, for the balance 9 years. But what we see is that the acquirer actually has taken again 15 years as a useful life. So there is no way the asset can work for 6 plus 15 years. So either one, a technical assessment has to be done based on the quality of the asset, whether it has got 9 years to go or 10 years to go or 12 years to go, or you basically take the balance useful life and not the full useful life. Very common mistake which we've come across in audits. Be mindful of this whenever you have transfer of assets between group companies, procurement of asset or a disposal of asset to a group company. The other common auditing area where we've seen errors is in case of vehicles. Vehicles typically company ends up taking in the names of the employee and not in the name of the company. So for asset like vehicle, always ask for the RC book. The RC book will specify who is the owner of the asset. So it cannot be in the name of the individual. It should be in the name of the company. So again, a common area, maybe because the corporate rates are higher than the individual rates when you procure a vehicle, or could be because of such reasons. But a common area where we've seen that while the asset is capitalized in the books of the company, paid by the company, the RC book actually could be in the name of the individual who is your employee. So be very careful while reviewing the FA title as well. Okay, moving to inventories. In case of inventories, again, a few common errors which we've seen. The incidental expenses which are required to bring the inventory to its present location and condition, very often your duties, taxes, which are required to be paid, clearing charges, certain installation charges, while the inventory gets accounted for, the related incidental charges don't get accounted for. That's again a non-compliance of AS2 and Ind AS2 both. When you're valuing your work in progress and finished goods, the overheads allocation, the overhead capitalization to WIP or FG, very basic errors, but especially in small and medium companies, and especially the ones who are not used to manufacturing, who's just started the manufacturing setup, you miss on identifying all the overheads, bifurcating between the fixed and variable overheads and allocating these overheads. The standard very clearly also specifies that the fixed overheads have to be allocated based on the normal capacity of a plant. Variable overheads will be based on actual production. But there are lots of errors which are noted when you are checking the inventory valuation at a particular client. So some basic reminders or you know some things to watch out for when you are doing the inventory valuation. The other aspect is, in fact, this was one of the points which was pointed out by FRRB also in their comments on Ind AS financial statements, where the net realizable value and the fair value is in the policy when you're defining for inventory, the valuation will be at cost or net realizable value, whichever is lower. Some companies end up using the word fair value. Fair value is different from net realizable value because fair value is the price which one could fetch in an open market. It's not an entity specific price, whereas a net realizable value is what that entity is going to be able to fetch for that particular inventory. And especially when you are looking at valuation of raw material or work in progress and you're assessing the net realizable value, this net realizable value has to be linked to two things. The standard says one is the selling price of the finished goods, because the intention is not to sell this RM or WIP. Intention is to manufacture and then sell the FG. So you have to consider the cost of completion and then compare it with the fair value or NRV of the finished goods. And if there is if the NRV of FG is lower, then there could be a inventory obsolescence for the RM or WIP. And second is the purchase price of subsequent purchase price of this raw material or work in progress, whether that has gone significantly lower compared to the price at which you purchase. If these two are not affected, then there is no NRV issue or no inventory obsolescence issue for RM and WIP. Again, this assessment very often not done by clients either if done or not adequately documented or absolutely not done by clients. So this is again an area which one should look at very carefully, and especially where the prices of finished goods have significantly reduced. If the company has ended up making losses or if the products are not selling, the net realizable value of RMFG WIP becomes very, very relevant. The other thing the standard requires, and very basic, this is relevant, is when you're looking at NRV, you have to look at a cost to sell also. So I will have some cost which I will need to incur for selling that particular inventory. It could be brokerage, it could be commission, it could be some marketing cost. So when you're doing a comparison of cost versus NRV, it has to be NRV less cost to sell. This both AS2 and Ind AS2 specifically include, but at times we've seen that the cost to sell are not included when the NRV assessment is done for inventories. Again, certain relevant points from a CARO perspective. Physical verification becomes very important, and especially now that both last year, if you look at 31st March 20 and 31st March 21, both the year ends, we were actually in a lockdown situation. So the year end stock counts would have been difficult. And how frequently and how periodically has management done their stock verifications, given the fact that for the major part of this year, the offices were not accessible, factories were not accessible to people. So how were the physical management controls by implemented by management? Very important and very relevant for small and mid-sized companies. How are the differences on physical verification addressed or adjusted in the books of accounts? Very important. And third thing which we've seen errors is where you have stocks lined with third parties. We've seen that year-end written confirmations are not obtained from such third parties. This is again something very relevant from a Karo perspective. So please be mindful when you're covering Karo, and it will be important to cover some of these items much earlier when you are discussing with your client rather than picking it up only at Karo, because more often than not, the teams start to work on Karo only after the normal audit is done, when they start drafting the audit report. But that may be too late, because these are some of the procedures which have implications on internal financial controls of the company. These will have implications if some of these controls are not effective. It may have impact on your detailed audit procedures that you're carrying out on various captions. So my sincere request would be, don't keep it for the year end. Don't keep it for the fag end or the closure of the audit. Discuss some of these elements upfront with the client, especially areas like physical verification, extremely relevant for the current year, given the fact that the offices, factories were not accessible to people. Some of the other similar errors which we've seen in inventories is if inventory is pledged with a third party for borrowings, for loans, borrowings or with banks or financial institutions, these are not disclosed. I covered third party confirmation for inventory. Goods in transit is very relevant from an account, the cutoff procedure. So a common area where we've seen interpretation issues or errors which are made by teams is to determine what were the terms of the contract, whether it was FOB, CIF, ex-factory, to the location where the goods are to be delivered. So all of those terms will be very relevant to determine what is the date when the goods are actually need to be accounted by your entity as purchases. Till such time, so if your terms are CIF and the goods have still not reached your location, but they've crossed custom frontiers of India, then these will have to be in transit, or it may be not purchases also. So to determine what are goods in transit, what are purchases is very relevant. So adequate cutoff procedures from a year-end perspective for such goods is important. And again, wherever you have purchase of material, from a related party, just like I mentioned in fixed assets also, you need to be very careful on an arm's length assessment, especially if that company is not in the business of selling that product. Then how was the pricing determined? Okay, moving to the next, trade and other receivables. Trade and other receivables, again, some errors which I have come across are if there are receivables for say reimbursement of expenses or it's just other expenses for which you have some receivables, these are not trade receivables, these are other receivables. What is trade receivables is only which is related to sale of goods or for rendering of services. So the classification is very important between trade and other receivables. The second error is the aging analysis, which is required for trade receivables, even for disclosure perspective, from a Schedule 3 requirements, is from the due date and not from the invoice date. Now, different customers may have different due dates or they may be fixed due dates. But when one is looking at the aging actually has to be from the due date and not from the invoice date. Very often, what clients will provide you is aging from the invoice date, which is incorrect. So be mindful and first check the data that you receive before you start checking the underlying information. Just check the data for correctness for some of these things, and these are very common errors. The bifurcation, the classification between what is a secured debtor and what is an unsecured debtor, what is considered good and where there is a credit risk increase or credit risk impairment. Very judgmental. At times, it is not backed up by adequate assessment and adequate supportings. So one needs to be mindful. The aging and the party-wise listing, which you get from the client, is actually something called as information produced by entity. And this needs to be tested for completeness and accuracy. So some basic checks to see that the total of parties listing tallies with your total receivables. So it's a subledger versus GL reconciliation. Checking that the aging is very correctly computed, because you're going to perform your audit work on that aging report which is provided to you by management. But is that aging report correct or not in the first place? You should check that before you jump into testing that data. When you come to provision for doubtful debts or for Ind AS companies expected credit loss, What is the credit risk assessment for each of the receivables? Is there a credit risk associated with parties or no? That assessment, again, from a management assessment as well as documentation point of view, we've always noted that there are errors. It's not done possibly in a thorough manner, especially in case of companies which have a very lean accounts and finance team. So one is doing some assessment of the receivables of that party's creditworthiness. Second is looking at the aging, the past past aging in terms of how regularly is the company paying your for the past dues, and if there are delays that one sees in this receivable from various parties, then there should be a provision which is made. A very important estimate of management. Wherever there are ad hoc provisions, say 5% of debtors are provided or 3% of receivables are provided, one needs to look at those 3%, 5%, whether they are appropriate based on the past trend. Management has to provide a detailed assessment of what was the pattern of collections, what was the pattern of write-offs in the past, and basis that whether the estimate which they have used, or whether it is a 3%, 5%, 10%, whether that's appropriate or not appropriate. Some of these are much more possibly explained when you come to the Ind AS. The erstwhile standards may not have it in as detailed assessment, but the auditing standards also cover requirements of each of these estimates and the basis of making these estimates. So be mindful in terms of what data you receive from the client and what is the work done in preparing that data, and what is the review process which is followed by management before they share the information with you. Moving to the next area on receivables, which is confirmations. This is also covered by SA 505 on external confirmations. Selecting the parties for rolling out confirmation, obtaining direct independent confirmations, very important. At times we've seen that confirmations are not rolled out independently. This is something which is mandated by the auditing standard. So audit teams should ensure that there are confirmations rolled out. Wherever you are sending email confirmation, you need to perform additional procedures to ensure that the emails which are being used are correct emails. The responses have to come directly from the third party to you directly, not through the client. We've seen a few errors in the manner in which the confirmations are obtained. If there are no responses from parties, the auditing standard requires follow-on emails, follow-ups to be made before you conclude on your audit. So there should be reminders which are sent, but we've also seen that just about one confirmation is rolled out and there are no reminders sent. If you receive responses, a detailed reconciliation. If the response does not match with the number reflected by your client, that needs to be done. Some of these things we've seen missing. Confirmations is an extremely important audit procedure, and a third party evidence is considered much more reliable than the direct evidence provided by the client. So one needs to be very mindful when you're following this process. At times it is performed by the junior most team member. So be very sure that adequate steps are being followed. The correct list of population is used for identification of parties. You are rolling out independent emails or hard copy documents to the parties, getting responses directly from the parties. And if there are no responses, give them 15 days, 3 weeks, and then send reminders before you conclude on audit or before you start performing altering procedures. Some other areas are where you have receivables from parties in which directors are interested. Schedule 3 requires you to give this disclosure. Companies Act requires to give this disclosure. At times, companies end up not disclosing this in the financial statements. And of course, when you're looking at related party transactions, this possibly will come in all my slides. You need to be mindful of arm's length assessment by management for the related party transaction. It is not sufficient for the company to say that it is a negotiated price and therefore arm's length. They have to benchmark it to other unrelated parties or for similar services to be able to justify that the price which is being charged is an arm's length price. Okay, moving to next. there are investments which are made by the company. few relevant areas or few relevant errors which again we've seen is the control assessment, and this is more relevant for Ind AS, where the control definition is slightly different compared to erstwhile Indian GAAP, where Indian GAAP just basically says more than 50% of voting power and more than 50% of composition of board of directors. Here it's driven under Ind AS by the relevant agreements, and there we've seen certain disconnects in the way control is viewed at, and therefore possibility is that you may end up calling a subsidiary a joint venture or a joint control as no control, where you have certain rights and powers which are given to you by as per the shareholders agreement. So this is something which one needs to be really mindful of when you're doing a control assessment. Wherever there are investments made in subsidiaries, JVs, associates, we've seen that the assessment of impairment is not very robust. More often than not, the company will say that, okay, this was my subsidiary and it is a strategic investment, so there is no diminution. But it's very important as auditors to look at what is the performance of the company for the underlying entity, what is the status of their last few years' losses, if the company has been making profits or losses, what is the net worth position of that company, what are the future projections of that company, is there an impairment or is there no impairment in that company. So all of this becomes very relevant. Also from, especially now, the last 15-18 months have actually reflected that some of the very healthy companies which did not have any cash flow problems now actually are dependent on financial support which is given by the parent company. After considering that financial support, the parent itself may have some challenges in for their own going concern. So very important for us to look at impairment and related assessment very, very closely. And especially when it comes to related parties. Other investments is slightly easier, but related parties, you may not get the relevant information. So important for an auditor to focus on these areas. Other investments, not so challenging, but it's just that at times we've seen that the disclosures of lower than cost and fair value and the measurement at FVTPL, there could be errors in disclosures. The disclosure of book value, market value of quoted investments at times is not disclosed in the financial statements, which is required by Schedule 3. Companies Act, a very relevant point here. Section 186.4 requires companies to give disclosures on movement in investments, especially with the purpose for which the investment was made. This disclosure, it's not a part of Schedule 3, it's not a part of accounting standards, but it's a requirement as per Companies Act. And this disclosure very often in the financial statements we've seen is missing. While the compliance with 186 may or may not be tested, in some cases I've come across errors where 186 compliance is also not tested. But very often the disclosure which is as per 186 is often missed out, and especially the purpose of the investment is missing. So this is something which one should be very careful. Some of the other areas where we've seen some gaps is again where investments are pledged as borrowings, the disclosure is missing. If the investments are not in the name of the company, that's a non-disclosure. Auditing estimates, the underlying data, how has management prepared the data, what are the assumptions used, the testing is not documented well enough. And management review controls, especially more often than not, either it is not reviewed, or if reviewed, there is no evidence of review by management over how the data was prepared and how this whole assessment was carried out. So this is something which one should be very careful. And given the fact that the financial position of a lot of companies has been affected because of the pandemic for the last 2 years now, actually, both March 20 and 21, and also the future being uncertain, this becomes an increased area of focus while you're finalizing your audits, or even when you're finalizing your accounts for those who are involved in preparation of accounts. Okay, loans given very similar to what I discussed for investments. As far as assessment of impairment is concerned, the future cash flows recoverability is concerned. In addition to this, let me just cover one or two other elements. Wherever the loans are, say, repayable on demand, these are considered to be repayable on demand, means these are repayable at any time when there is a demand which is made. Typically, the term is considered to be less than 12 months or 12 months. However, these are never demanded, and therefore these just keep getting rolled over. In such cases, for the rollover loan, this is considered a fresh loan. The board approvals, the agreements, etc., have to be renewed. Very often, for private companies, for small mid-sized companies, the necessary board approvals, the agreements are not in place. And the relevant disclosures are also not there. Again, a repayable on demand is a short-term loan, because this is the borrower has to pay the money whenever demanded by the lender. So it is all short-term loans. So here the approvals, also the arm's length assessment for every time a renewal happens needs to be made. So some of these elements, if you look at, I mean, it's a combination of Section 185, 186, 188 of Companies Act, Ind AS 109, CARO requirements, and Schedule 3. And as you may be aware, CARO, the new CARO has actually increased the reporting requirements on this area quite significantly. So this is again something where we've seen both from an accounting policy disclosure as well as the documentation which is maintained at clients to be lacking in a lot of cases, and this should be definitely focused on when you're closing your year-end audits. Same is the case for other loans. And a very important point, which is on Section 185, when companies are giving loans under 185 and 186, the Companies Act rules actually require the lender, which is your company who's giving the loan, to ensure that you very clearly identify the purpose for which you're giving such loans, and also to ensure that the loan is utilized for the purpose for which you've granted these loans. At times, again, when you're auditing, you will realize that the company does not have the necessary evidence to demonstrate why they gave the loan and whether that loan was used for the purpose for which they gave it or not. Those are elements which are missing. Very important requirements from a Companies Act perspective. So please ensure that you ask the right questions and you get the necessary backup from your clients. Guarantee securities given again at times are missed out from disclosures completely. When you're giving related party disclosures, be mindful that a guarantee and a security, though it is non-cash nature, it is a financial guarantee. This needs a disclosure from a related party transaction point of view. Only transactions which are on balance sheet end up getting disclosed. Off balance sheet transaction, we've seen often errors in reporting those transactions. So be mindful of this. Moving to other areas is basically just getting confirmations and adequate disclosures for related parties. I'll move to next. Moving to borrowings, in case of borrowings, very clearly when you're auditing borrowings, you should get the necessary evidence of what is the purpose of the loan, what is the security of the loan, how are the funds being utilized, were they used for the purpose for which they were taken. There are reporting implications both in Schedule 3 and from a CARO perspective. If there are defaults in payment of principal and interest, these need to be given. Also, one area which we've seen is often ignored or not tested is compliance with debt covenants. There will be certain debt covenants which will be defined in the agreement. It could be maintaining a debt service coverage, it could be interest coverage, it could be certain returns which are committed. And if any of these covenants is not met or not made good before the year end, and not waived off by the bank, the classification of your entire borrowing will become short term, because the banks will always have a right to demand the loan, even though it's a long term loan. Bank will always say that if any of these covenants are not met, then the bank has a right to demand the loan. And if that be the case, then your presentation, classification, disclosures in the financial statements will get affected. Very often we've come across teams not asking the right questions, not getting details on compliance with debt covenants, and often missing this important area. So that's why I thought I should just bring this out. Coming to intercorporate loans or deposits, which are ICDs, it could be from shareholders, relatives, directors, or corporates. One needs to be mindful of compliance with Section 73 to 76, which is on acceptance of deposit rules. There is the company has restrictions on accepting loans from individuals that are not shareholders, directors. So one should be very careful that this is not qualifying if you are a private company, and this does not qualify as an acceptance of deposit. So compliance is very often we've seen not tested. That is one. Second, where it is a loan which is from an individual, the individual has to confirm that the money is being lent to the company from his own sources and not borrowed fund. This is a specific requirement from an acceptance of deposits rules. This is missed out, and if that is not taken on record, effectively it means that you as a private company were not entitled to accept public deposit, and you've done that, so it's actually a violation. Also, the arm's length assessment for wherever loans are borrowed from group companies or from individuals, how do they compare with bank loan? We've seen that the documentation and the underlying details are not sufficient to demonstrate arm's length, because you know your bank loans will be secured loans, will be either depending on short term, long term loan, you will have a full coverage. There could be margin money, etc., kept for bank loan, and those will be say at 8, 9, 10%, and you will have unsecured loans from group companies at say 12%. But how do you justify whether the 12% was the right rate for an unsecured loan, which was a short-term on-demand kind of loan? The documentation which your client has, and if you are management, the documentation which you maintain for demonstrating that the rate which you're charging is an arm's length rate is often insufficient. Similarly, the board approvals do not include all the elements of what is the purpose of loan, what is the security, what are the other terms and conditions. In case of banks, financial institution related borrowings, we've seen that the documentation is quite covered and is sufficient, but the same does not exist in some cases when it is an intercompany loan. So please be mindful when you are finalizing or when the board is also giving approvals for this loan, all the relevant elements need to be very correctly incorporated. The next point is actually more relevant from an Ind AS where you have debentures and preference shares. The classification between debt, equity, or whether it's a compound instrument, and elements of debt equity need to be split up, or if there is an embedded derivative. We've seen a lot of errors in identification and classification, especially for Ind AS companies. The compliance with the terms of issue, which is Section 42 of Companies Act, again, we've seen some non-compliances. Applicability of DRR, CRR, your debenture redemption reserve, your capital redemption reserve, as applicable as per Companies Act provision, at times is missed out. And this is something which, again, one needs to be mindful of when you have debentures and preference shares. And of course, if you're an Ind AS company, the carrying value, when you're carrying an at amortized cost, it has to be as per effective interest method, including the moratorium period, any processing fee, upfront fee which is paid. So all of those have to be done quite thoroughly. We've seen some errors in some of these calculations as well. Finally, the disclosures in respect of borrowings, especially when the loans, short-term unsecured loans are disclosed, I have seen that interest terms, repayment terms are often missing. The requirements for secured, unsecured loans, non-current and current borrowings covers security terms, covers interest terms, covers repayment terms as per Schedule 3. However, these are not given for all loans because some of the companies interpret that it's applicable only for long-term borrowings and not short-term borrowings. The guidance note very clearly clarifies that this is applicable to all the borrowings. Details of default, if there are any during the year, made good before the year end or after the year end, at times are not disclosed, but this is also required to be disclosed. Okay, moving on. Trade payables, very similar to what I discussed in case of trade receivables, only some additions here. especially when it comes to MSME parties. Identification of MSME parties, lots of errors again here. One, the companies need to have a process in place to identify MSME on a periodic basis. Having possibly included a vendor acceptance form which covers MSME parties is not sufficient because the position of the company may change during the year also. So getting a confirmation at minimum on an annual basis of whether you are a micro party or a small party or a medium party is important. Second is systems and processes to track the due date of payment and actual date of payment made to this MSME parties again is something which is missing. MSME parties, as all of you may be aware, if you don't pay within 45 days, you are required to pay interest, which is 3 times the bank rate. Tracking the due date and the actual date of payment throughout the year becomes absolutely necessary. We've seen large companies not doing it. Small and medium companies actually don't even have a process in place for this. Again, an area of absolute importance. The assessment of due date at times becomes a point of contention, especially when you are when the MSME party is rendering services and not selling goods. If it is service, whether the date of receipt of service or the invoice date becomes the due date is very important to establish. In goods, it's very easy because you know your GRIR date or your GRN date, which will very clearly indicate when you've received the goods and you have an invoice date, and you can say whichever is earlier or whichever is later. But in case of services, this becomes very critical to determine. Also, there would be special situations where, for example, you've got MSME to do some contract work for you and you have a retention money payable. So the obligation of that MSME party towards retention, is it on the day the invoice is raised or is it on the day the liquidated damages period is expiring, and after that you pay the retention money. So what is the due date in case of retention money payable is again a matter of discussion. So if you have such specific situations, earlier you discuss with your client, it's better, and if you need any consultants, etc., views to be taken, then you can obviously have those discussions earlier to be able to conclude on the disclosures as well as the interest liability to MSME parties, if any. I think one more area in trade tables which I would like to highlight is the testing of accruals, completeness of accruals, which is something we call as period 13 testing. The period subsequent to the year end to check whether the accruals have been made for all services which were services as well as goods which were received prior to 31st March, whether that's been appropriately recorded or not. This is very important. More often than not, the team does not perform period 13 testing. For some listed companies, at times it's a challenge because entries related to the month of April may not have been passed in the books. And for unlisted companies, especially using accounting systems like Tally, etc., may not have a trail of or something called as period 13 because they don't lock the systems, and therefore entries related to March 31st, you may come across them passing entries even in the month of June and July. So very important process from an audit perspective. One needs to be very careful in identifying the accruals, whether these are complete or not. And in whichever way, whatever your situation is, please ensure that you do period 13 testing to demonstrate that all accruals are rightly accounted in the right period. Moving on employee benefits, I'm just going to cover a few provisions. I'm covering the next slide on provision as well, contingent liability and provision. This is specifically restricted to employee benefits. Some of the common errors that we've come across, classification of current and non-current is not correct when it comes to gratuity and leave. There are, and especially when it comes to leave encashment or compensated absences as per the standard, The guidance not very clearly explains that if an employee, if as per the terms of the employment contract, if employee wants to take the leave and the company employer doesn't have a right to defer the leave, then the entire leave related provision should be classified as current. However, we've come across instances where leave gets classified both as current and non-current. While it could be non-current would be appropriate, but then one has to be very clear that as per employment terms or basis the past trend, etc., you have enough justification to demonstrate that there is an ability of the employer to defer the leave. If the employer doesn't have the ability to defer the leave, then the classification should be current. Another area of error, if I may say, is in provision for leave specifically, bifurcated between leave availment and leave encashment. Leave availment is basically taking leave while you are in service. So I may have 30 days of leave balance available to me. Possibilities, I'll utilize 15 days while I'm in service and 15 days I'll encash. The encashment is always at basic plus DA. However, availment is I'm enjoying paid leave when I'm availing the leave balance while I'm in service. Now, the provision for leave availment actually should be at full CTC because I'm going to not work for 15 days and get my full salary for those 15 days, whereas the 15 days which I'm going to encash is only going to be at basic. So the provision for encashment should be only at basic salary or basic NDA. Availment has to be at your full CTC. Very often, neither the actuary, neither the company splits this properly, and therefore you end up making only an encashment provision, which is actually under providing for your liability, or you end up making a full provision of only availment. So firstly, to understand the leave policy of the company, what is accumulated leave allowed to be carried forward? Of that, how much will be encashed, how much will lapse, and how much can be utilized while you are in service? One needs to understand and then accordingly see that the data which is given to actuary also covers all of these elements for the purposes of your early valuation. So an area where probably 9 out of 10 cases, I can very surely say that there is an error, and only after either the auditors pointing out or someone from management pointing out or actuary pointing out, this gets rectified. So be mindful when you're doing when you're reviewing leave valuation. Provident fund, not relevant in all companies, but wherever the company has its own trust or has its own fund and does not contribute to a government recognized fund, the provident fund actually could be a defined benefit and not a defined contribution. A defined contribution is where the contribution of the employer, which is your company, which you are preparing accounts for or doing the audit for. The defined contribution is where the contribution for that entity is known number. It is a fixed number, which is what I do when I pay to a government recognized fund, and any excess gains or losses of that particular fund is something borne by the fund only, which is government recognized trust in this case. However, if I'm having my own fund or my own trust, the gains or losses or shortfall in that fund, I will have to make good. And therefore, in those cases, provident fund becomes a defined benefit. There was a specific FAQ on AS 15, which clarified this position. However, this still continues to be an area where we see some errors, where companies don't classify PF appropriately as a defined benefit or a contribution. Some of the other areas where we've seen errors is when you're looking at a bonus provision, the assessment of what is allocable surplus and how much is the maximum bonus or a minimum bonus required as per Payment of Bonus Act. At times you will say, clients will come and tell you, we've made 8% of whatever is the basic salary payable as bonus provision. But 8% may not be appropriate. 8% is maximum bonus only if you don't have allocable surplus. If you have allocable surplus and the Payment of Bonus Act actually gives the formula for calculation of allocable surplus, then the maximum bonus will actually be 20%. Or rather, the minimum bonus will be 20% and not only 8%. So this is something, and it's a statutory payment. One needs to be very careful whether the accrual is being correctly made or not. Of course, this will change to a certain extent because of Code of Social Security. But one needs to be very mindful of the Bonus Act for March 21 audits at least. The other area where we've seen is performance-linked incentives. While this may be an area where client may not be willing to share a lot of data because of confidentiality and sensitivity attached to it, one needs to do a review of this estimate of what was the past provision versus the past payouts, and whether to see whether the accruals or the management judgment for the accruals has been appropriate or not appropriate. Often this is found missing. The third element is long-term incentive plans. This is an area where we've seen errors in accounting completely, because one, long-term incentive plans are supposed to be actuarially valued because they are long-term in nature. There will be assumptions involved in eligibility as well as repayment, as well as payment of these long-term incentives. However, at times these are either not provided or these are provided only as and when paid, both of which are incorrect. So this is again an area which one needs to look at very carefully. The next area is stock options. Stock options, there are various specific guidances which cover employee share-based payments and for a company which is not listed, for a listed company, for an Ind AS company, one needs to follow compliance with these relevant guidance. We've seen that often stock options are not accounted for, especially if your employee is entitled to stock options of your holding company or any other group company. At times it does not come get captured in the books at all, which is incorrect. So this is something, if you have not specifically asked the question, if there is any group company which would have given stock options, this is a question which you definitely need to ask management and ensure that the accounting for the stock options is done correctly in the books of account. Okay, moving to next. Contingent liabilities and provision. Here, a few observations. Again, I'm just focusing on the common errors which are noted. Disputed dues are reported in CARO. Disputed dues where management believes that the exposure is low or moderate are reported also in contingent liability. Very often, we've seen differences in these two. Simply speaking, demand less any provision made should be reflected in contingent liability, and demand less any payment made should be reported in CARO. So very clear reconciliation should exist between the two to ensure all taxes are covered, all elements, all demands are covered. More often than not, we've seen that there are errors or disconnects between the two. So if when you're completing your audit, please be mindful of this and please check this as well. Second area where we've seen some inconsistencies is some entities end up reporting show cause notices where there is no demand. It's just a show cause notice where you are required to come and meet the authorities with certain information. Those are also reported in contingent liabilities, and in some cases there could be a show cause come demand notice, but it's not reported in contingent liability or provision. So again, an area which one needs to be very careful, where there is a show cause but no demand, or there is show cause come demand notice. The other area where again we've seen some gaps is where the matter is not concluded fully. It is one probably at a particular level, but either you or the counterparty has the ability to appeal, and that appeal period is not yet over. So just because the matter is concluded at a lower level, does not mean that the assessment is closed, and therefore you remove it from disclosures till the time that the appeal possibility is there. So be very careful when you are concluding or when you are removing certain adjustments from your from the disclosures in the financial statements. On subsequent events, what we've come across is what are adjusting subsequent events and what are non-adjusting subsequent events. The understanding, and there are at times interpretations which are different or incorrect. So be very careful when you're looking at certain subsequent events and see whether the fact pattern existed on the balance sheet date or not to determine whether this was an adjusting event or a non-adjusting event. Also, the disclosures in respect of material subsequent events at times are missing in the financial statements. This is something which is mandatory as per the standard. Please ensure that these are disclosed. The disclosures in case of contingent liability very often don't have a quantification. Quantification is required for contingent liability. So please ensure that the quantification is made unless it is absolutely not possible to measure it, in which case the reason for non-measurement and the fact that it is not measurable should also be mentioned. Also, the quality of content from a drafting perspective is very often inadequate or very generic wording which is used. As a reader of financial statements, please go through the disclosure and see whether the relevant matter is being explained thoroughly or not explained. And if there are gaps, then that's something which you should fix in discussion with the client. Onerous contracts, I have seen that these are not disclosed. These are those contracts which are not executory. This is there could be significant losses in case an onerous contract is not complied with. There are relevant disclosures required by the standard for an onerous contract, but those at times are missing in the financial statements. And very often the distinction between a contingent liability and provision is very difficult to make, because what exactly you would make the item a contingent liability and not a provision. So please ensure that the documentation, the related, if you need to involve any expert to give you a clearance, if you need an external legal opinion, etc., ensure that those are in place before concluding something being a contingent liability or a provision. Some of the other matters is how well you communicate these matters to those charged with governance, involvement of subject matter experts, like I said, including any legal opinions, and ensure that the correlation between the disclosures in the audit report and the financial statements are consistent. Okay, moving to statement of changes in equity. I think I'm running out of time. I'll just move through very quickly. So statement of share capital and changes in equity, I think couple of elements which I just want to cover here, especially when there are shares which are issued, which are reserved for issue under a contract or a commitment. So where you have fully or partly convertible instruments, or you have stock options, these are convertible into equity shares. There's a specific disclosure requirement as per Schedule 3, which talks of giving the details of such shares which are going to be issued, because there's a commitment which exists for this. That often is missing. Again, a very basic thing, that the correct name of legal entities, holdco, subsidiary, etc., is not being included. I'll move to next. Revenue, just one or two significant observations which I want to highlight is the accounting policy. At times when you look at the streams of revenue and when you look at the accounting policy, there is a mismatch. Some of the streams of revenue are not included in the accounting policy correctly. So that is something one needs to be mindful of. Second is where you have other operating revenue and other income. So, for example, sale of scrap is specifically covered under other operating revenue as per the guidance norm, and there could be some elements which could be other income. The distinction or the classification at times is incorrect. And of course, the disclosures as per 115, Ind AS 115 are very, very detailed. Those we've seen often missing in the Ind AS financials. A few other matters, I'll probably just jump through this in the interest of time. Going concern assessment, while this slide I've just captured the requirements, something which I want to specifically cover, given the fact that companies are going through a difficult phase, as auditors, as management, it's important to look at the next 12 to 24 months projection. Look at what are the elements of payments which you have to make, including borrowed funds which are falling due for payment, and look at the sources of fund which the company has to meet these liabilities as and when they fall due. If there is reliance on, say, a financial support of a parent or any other group company, it's not sufficient just to take that financial support letter. You will also have to perform some procedures to see whether the parent or whichever entity whose financial support letter you've taken, do they have the ability to fund you as and when you need the funds, or do they themselves face any going concern issues? And if they have given a commitment, whether their own cash flow projection includes that commitment or not. So it's an area of focus. There is enough and more guidance which is being issued by Institute on going concern. I would request sincerely, please ensure that you follow that. Especially the last 2 years, this has become an area of significant focus. Some of the elements which is more relevant for an audit. One is to ensure that your appointment process, your independence, especially when you are rendering also some non-audit services, these are ensured, these are in place. There is clear evidence that no restricted services are being provided by you as auditors to the company that you are auditing. planning the audit, I've just listed out certain accounting standards, auditing standards, which require regular communication with either those charged with governance, early interaction with management, deciding the right benchmark for the purpose of audit, performing preliminary procedures. At times, especially when you're auditing small companies, the planning phase and execution phase is actually just merged, but just ensure that you have those regular communications with management. Execution of audit, what are some of the gaps which we've seen in execution of audit? More around the documentation, I've covered in fact caption wise where we have some challenges on documentation. So please ensure that that is followed. And of course, in completion of audit, certain common errors and certain gaps that I've seen in documentation of what work as auditors has been done and whether that's sufficient or not. One of the elements here which I've also covered is the gaps identified by FRRB. There were observations by FRRB on disclosures in financial statements. I believe earlier there was a detailed session covered on this. Please go through some of those disclosures. Those are errors which are seen by FRRB as a regulator in the financial statements of various companies for Ind AS. Please ensure that if there are those similar gaps existing in your companies, those are taken care of. I think that's all I had. Happy to take questions. I've just got some appendices where I've covered some of the literature which one needs to refer to, but that's about it. I'm done. Any questions, I can pick up those now.
Thank you, Mansi Madam, for your comprehensive presentation. There is no presently any question right now, but I would like to ask a small question from my side. That especially now in this COVID pandemic situation, how will we, what kind of document would you suggest we keep for going concern assessment? Just one or two documents if you can highlight, and then we will move quickly to the quiz round.
Sure. Going concern, like I said, is a very important area of focus. What you need to do from a going concern, so firstly, it's just not sufficient if the company has positive net worth or is profit making. It may not necessarily be sufficient. One needs to really look at in terms of what are the liabilities which are falling due in the next 12 months. What is the ability of the company to pay those liabilities as and when they fall due? And if you see that there are any gaps, then what you need to ask for very clearly is obtain cash flow projections from management. And these cash flow projections typically should cover why minimum 12-month period is required. I think the recommendation is to go for a longer duration. So look at the next 12 to 24 months or maybe 36 months if depending on the sector in which your company is. Look at all the sources of funds which the company has. Critically examine each of these sources of funds. It could be repayment of your debtors, it could be any existing line of credits available with the banks, or it could be sale of investments, or it could be certain tax refunds, etc., which may be due. Look at the management estimate of whether the projections, the predictions to say when this money will be collected is appropriate, reasonable or no. Look at all the payments which are falling due, your normal creditors' payments, bank borrowings, principal, interest, repayments when they are falling due. And if you believe that there are there is a possibility of deficit, your sources of funds are not sufficient, I would prefer a month-wise cash flow projection. So if any month you see that there is a gap, say a big long-term debt is falling due for repayment, but the company does not have sufficient funds to pay, the question is, what is the basis? And if the company says that, you know, I'm going to tie up some term loans with banks, or I'm going to raise funds from my parent company by way of issue of equity shares, or there is a commitment to infuse loan by a parent company, or there is a financial support letter, just those explanations will not be sufficient. If there is a term loan which is going to be obtained by bank, you need to see the sanction letter and other documents. If there is a loan or a right issue committed, you need to take the necessary approvals and a letter from the parent of that commitment. And similarly, if there's a financial support letter, you need an unconditional financial support letter, sorry. In addition to that unconditional support letter, you also need to also look at the net worth and the financial position of the parent to be able to conclude that the parent will be able to support your company as and when they need funds. So some of these elements become very relevant given the fact that companies are going through difficult phases. And depending on which sector in which your company is, you possibly need to be more careful on before you conclude on going concern. I hope I've answered.
Thank you, Chintu. Yes, I think that was a very nice answer also, and it clarified a lot of things. Before we move on to the quiz round, for quick, I request the participants to please be there. We will just quickly resume with the quiz round for 6-7 quick questions. But before that, let me take the pleasure of thanking CA Mansi Padiwala for her such a, her session was really very clarifying certain common mistakes. Especially, I like the fact that she highlighted on the use of specific wordings and rather not to use or avoid specific wordings like generally operating effectively or certain things. I think we need to recheck our audit report when we are finalizing it and not do only copy paste, to be very frank, and really check for such kind of mistakes which she has so kindly put up in a very nice manner. So thank you, CA Mansi, for such a wonderful presentation. I'm sure all the participants will definitely benefit from it. Over to Drushti Madam, do you want to say add something more? Or we can move to the quiz round.
So we can move to the quiz, but Mansi, it was so nice, I must say. It was so well organized, the way you had put up every part of the care that the auditor has to take, and even of course for the management also, because unless they prepare it, auditors are not going to be able to audit that properly. So sure. I think excellent presentation also, and very good way in which you could just explain every part of this. And now we have this session on quiz, and we have Rinkal with us as usual, who will be putting up a few simple questions for all the participants to answer those quiz questions. So Rinkal, a very, very highly awaited session from your side. So please, can you just take it forward? Rinkal, we can't hear you.
Rinkal, we are unable to hear you.
It was a lovely session taken up by Mansi, and when I was hearing the session, I think one more session is required by her, and especially on the going concern topic that she said, it is really an important topic. Maybe Drushti, we can have a look over it, and it is a very upcoming thing that we have to, after 2 years, what's the scenario, are they ready for it or not, we should be thinking. Now I have a Ritu, I cannot see the question answer part out here in my today though. So I think you will have to, every time I get, I'm not able, and I spoke to Subhash also. So if I raise a question, I would request everybody to put the answer on chat, or Ritu, you could help me out, because that thing is not coming, the question answer thing. So since the time is very less, we will quickly run through a small quiz, as Drishti always has decided to make this a more interactive session rather than just, hear and then go back. So the first question that we begin with is, since we all heard Mansi, so this day I may decided more to pick up the things from the whatever she has given up today. So the first question that I raise is that she was insisting on a period testing for trade payables. So the period testing on trade payables. So I wanted to know period dash. What is that number that she was saying testing for trade payables? Period dash testing for trade payables. She was saying it what, 2 or 3 times. Ruta, anybody is answering? I'm not getting on the question answer. Hello.
Ruta madam.
Oh.
Madam, आपका mic नहीं है. आपका mic में से mic call करिए.
Ruta ma'am, mic. मेरे को answers नहीं आ रहे. Question answer का answers नहीं आ रहे.
Actually, I'm not able to see the answers.
Yeah, even I'm not able to see the answer. क्वेश्चंस में ओरली बोलूंगी क्वेश्चन आंसर वाला वो प्लेटफॉर्म नहीं दिख रहा है
नहीं स्मॉल दिख रहा सुभाष सर
रिंकल मैडम अभी आप देखिए हेलो
हेलो
या सो द आंसर I've got the answer by Sairama, Chirag. Yeah, so it's period 13 testing. Very true. Period 13 testing is very important for the trade payables. And as for the new Companies Act, definitely trade payable is a very important thing. The second question, which section in the Companies Act relate to loans to group companies? Which three sections of the Companies Act relate to loan to group companies? Yes, Sarosh Irani, you are partly right, partly wrong. Yeah, I've got the right answer for Poonam Panchrayani. It is section 185, 186 and 188. Dikshita, where to answer? Here only you have to answer. So yes, section 185, 186 and 188 of the Companies Act talks about loans to group companies. But the new Companies Act has reduced the time limit of residency from 180 days to how much? The new budget has reduced the time limit. Yes, Mr. Gopal Krishnan, you're absolutely right. The reduced time limit from 180 days has been reduced to 120 days for the residency limit for one person company as per the budget 2021. How to answer, Mr. Chandrasekhar Iyer? You have to write the where you've written how to answer. Just write the answer out there so we know. So this answer is being 120 days is given right by Gopal Krishnan Iyer and Subramaniam Duran. The next question. The relevant guidance, the essay, the relevant essay guidance for confirmation of relevance receivables is what? I want to know the essay number, which is for confirmation of receivables. Yeah, Dikshita Thakkar. Yes, it is essay 505. Dikshita, Mr. Chandrasekhar Iyer, Poonam. It is essay 505, which talks about the relevant guidance of confirmation of receivables. Now, the security deposits have to be classified as what? Earlier, we used to classify security deposits as long-term loans and advances. But the new amendment has asked for a different classification. What is the classification for security deposits? There is a new classification by the amendment for security deposits. When I'm preparing the financial statement, what is it? Ruta, am I audible? I'm audible. Hello?
Yes.
So earlier we used to put security deposits as long-term loans and advances. But the new amendment has given a different classification to it. What is it? Okay, I think I'll give it. It is other non-current assets. So now security deposits cannot be put under long-term loans and advances. It has to be put under other non-current assets. I would like to know the next question. Accounting standard for investment. Yeah, Mr. Arushi Singhal, thank you. It's the right one. Other non-current assets. Yeah, Drishti Thakkar. This is the right one. The accounting standard for investment. I think this she gave it in a lot in the slide. So yeah, so now I have lots of answers. Yeah, Mr. Chandrasekhar and Mr. Tripti Doria, it is accounting standard 13, which is the standard for investment. So if we have to read investments, we have to go to accounting standard 13. what is the form INC22 active? What was that form INC22A active? It is a very old form, but how many of you remember that we all have to fill up those forms? INC Inc. 22A active. We'll definitely share. Yeah, it was, the form was active companies tagging and verification. When 2013 came and the new forms came, we had to fill up this Inc. 22A active. That was for the active companies tagging and verification. Whoever did not fill up were either striped off or closed off. Okay, as for the new budget 2021, can you tell me the definition of a small company? What is the paid up amount and the turnover amount? Yeah, Chirag and Arushi, that was the geotagging, very true. Now the next question, what is the paid up amount and the turnover amount as per the new budget for a definition of a small company? They have changed the definition of a small company in the budget 2021. Yes, capital 50 lakhs, turnover 200, no. A small company. No, 50 lakhs is not there. Yes, Akshay Tambe, you're absolutely right, but only partly right. Here comes. Mr. Chirag Siani, yes, and Arushi Singhal. Yes, the capital should be, the paid up capital should be 2 crores and turnover up to 20 crores is a small company. So anything below this are all small companies as per the new budget. The next is, when should you start calculating the aging of receivables? From which date you should start calculating aging of receivables? Yeah, Mr. Gopal Krishna and Andrishti Kakkar. Yeah, we've got right answer. Yeah, it is all from the due date and not from the date invoice, Mr. Akshay. It is only from the date of the due date. And okay, last two questions. Two questions. On which date did the Companies Act 2013 was passed? The date on which the Companies Act 2013 was passed. Very good. Akshay Tambe, yes, it's absolutely right. 29th August 2013, the Companies Act 2013 was passed by the President in the Lok Sabha, and then now we are working on it by the Prime. The last question, does the Companies Act is applicable to Jammu and Kashmir? Is the Companies Act 2013 applicable to the state of Jammu and Kashmir? Yes, it is applicable. It is to the entire nation. So it is applicable. Even the earlier act was applicable, but there were certain things. But now 2013 is completely applicable to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, since we have less of time, Ruta, maybe we could pick up in the next session more questions. Which is already 6:30. And it was really fun because the participants were really interactive and we had lots of answers coming, you know. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Drushti madam, on behalf of WIRC, shall I tell the participants that whatever questions they have, we will send it to the presenter and speaker, and she will get back to them because there are some 4-5 questions which I could see right now.
So, okay. And we will be sharing the PPT also.
Thank you. Yes. In fact, in a week, 10 days, the entire program will be uploaded on our YouTube channel. So that program will be available for viewing anyways. Only you don't get your CPE hours, that's it. Oh, but you can view it, yeah.
Yeah, thank you. So shall we close now?
Thank you so much, Ruta. Thank you very much, Rinkal. And it was really a wonderful session, even this interactive session and the entire program. And Ruta, thanks for all the support that you have provided, even Shweta, all the coordinators. Thank you very much, all of you. And we had this wonderful session today. Four sessions over. If you attend two more sessions, then you will get some, you know, memento from WIRC for this WOW series. And with this, we bring this to a close, and we'll meet again next month with another session, something interesting which is relevant for the time.
Thank you.
See you then. Bye-bye.